Hola, coconuts, we're back. Now, I always want to have a decent conversation if we can. And I want to talk this week about what I think I'm going to call racialism. Some of us here, myself included, can't always get it right, but this is why we're here, to have these open discussions without fear or favour. Now, Narinda, who is on my left here, quite rightly, and Bushra, who is on my right. Narinda, the last time we spoke, you called Rishi Sunak a coconut.
And Suella Braverman, yes, they're coconuts.
Can I call you a coconut?
You can call me a coconut, yeah, I am a bit.
Why would I want to?
Well, you can if you want. I don't mind, it's fun.
Do you see it as a pejorative?
No, I don't. I see it as something that's in our community and we can say it. You can say it as well because I'm not that sensitive. I'm not as sensitive as you are to when we say talk about racism and colonisation and, you know, all of that. You get sensitive. I'm not sensitive because I don't have guilt.
What does the word coconut bring into your mind when you hear it?
It means you're brown on the outside, white on the inside, which means you're not really brown. You're trying to be white. You don't really know what you are. It's just the foul word, Narinda.
It's not a foul
Somebody
word
called
at
me
all.
That on Twitter the other day, and I was so annoyed.
Well,
and
well,
I thought,
don't get annoyed. I can be a coconut.
But Bushra was upset and annoyed, and it hurt her. So we don't walk around, for example, saying the N-word to people. Because
the community, the black community can say the N-word and the Asian community can say the coconut word. We can.
Do we get any words? Do I get any words?
Well, it's up to you. Just discuss with your community. But in the black community, you can say the N-word and the Asian community, you can say the C-word. Lawrence, you won't win on this.
I'm not
trying to win.
Hold on. Slow down. I want this to be a healthy conversation.
Yeah, let's have healthy.
I don't want to do like, you're not going to win. It's not about winning. I don't care about winning. I just want to talk.
Let's talk.
Bushra.
Yeah. What I was going to say is that you see the thing about terminology and stuff, I get that people claim words and they can have those words amongst themselves, but I couldn't go out there with somebody that I knew and call them coconut. It's just not right because I know what that word means, so why would I want to call somebody that?
Is it racist, would you say?
I believe there is definitely a racial element attached to it because if you're calling somebody internally white, even though they look brown, what you're saying is you've sold us out. You've actually sold our community.
But not in a bad way.
So are we saying that racist part of it is to go, you're a coconut because you're not sort of politically brown?
Yes, exactly.
And that's my problem with it. If you're brown, brown people think like this, which is kind of racist.
It's almost like boxing communities up and saying that if you don't think like us, it's not the herd mentality.
It means you're whitewashed. It means that you've become more like the country you've emigrated to and you've forgotten
your
roots.
But why is that wrong?
And there's nothing wrong with that.
That's wonderful.
I don't like Indian music. I love English music. I don't particularly like a fancy white man. That makes me a coconut, but there's nothing wrong with that. You know, claim it. It's nothing bad.
But Narinda, can you understand why, whilst you hold that view, a lot of people might think that was a racist view to hold?
I think some... In our community, it's not racist. So...
OK. But obviously...
It's not racist, so...
In your community? I don't understand what your community means.
So, in the South Asian community, it's not considered racist.
But I'm South Asian and I'm contesting the word, so therefore it's not used in a majority
way. I say that's
a
small minority how you feel. I think that's guilt.
Hang on, that's not guilt. We're trying to have a decent conversation where we don't judge people and call them guilty for finding somebody offended. Right, OK. I want to move on. Bushra... who, you know, her and I disagree about a lot of things, you and I disagree about a lot of things, but we all get on.
Isn't it crazy?
Almost like we need to stop talking about all this skin colour rubbish because it's killing stuff. Bushra tweeted, seriously, a part of me just wants to shut down the Britain stole everything discussion. I'm not allowed to say that, I promise not to say that. FFS. What is done is bad. Beep. Happens to everyone. Some gain more than others. The world is messed up. All history is going on about... it solves nothing. We're here, living in this country, Great Britain now. 99% of those speaking out 24/7 about this wouldn't go and live in those countries, even if these things, like the diamond, etc., were returned. So pipe down. Trust me, if you had millions of money, of your own money, you wouldn't give it airtime. Not this much, anyway. Make your own money instead. Should have and could have now. For the love of God, unmute my account with crown pictures of a looted diamond. Right. Can you explain to us what you were saying there?
I was saying that I'm exhausted. I'm saying that I'm tired. I am so tired and fed up of this debate that we keep bringing up about the diamond, about the Kohinoor, about reparations, about people being unhappy about historical times that are centuries ago.
Not centuries, 1919 was the Amritsar Massacre.
How are we going to move forward if we do not...
Shall I tell you how? Shall I tell you how?
Hold on. At a time, please. Thank you.
So what I think about is I think I'm tired, I'm exhausted, I can't deal with those conversations anymore. I want us to move forward. So what about looking at the solution? What does the solution look like? What would make
Shall
people...
Shall I tell you the solution looks like?
What does the solution look like to you?
OK, the solution looks like acknowledging and not having this little whimsical attitude of, oh, I'm tired.
Can we not be judgy? Please, can we not be judgy?
OK.
Can we not be judgy?
OK,
you've
this
asked,
is the
been
solution.
Asked, no, please. Otherwise, I don't want to have this chat and you
Lawrence.
Can leave.
OK.
It's like, sit down. You've been asked a question. The question is, what do you see the solution?
What you do is
you don't turn around and character judge someone. You offer a solution in a calm and rational way, Narendra. I spoke to you about this before we went on air. Grow up.
Solution is we acknowledge, we talk about it, we don't deny, we have some acknowledgement of what the past atrocities was.
Why?
Saying...
Why?
Because it's disrespectful to the millions of people killed at the hands of the British government.
So let's acknowledge it happened. We all acknowledge it happened.
You didn't acknowledge. We haven't acknowledged.
You're on television acknowledging it now.
I am.
Right. Do we need to go to a graveyard, dig some people up and go, sorry, skeleton, what do we do?
See, now you're doing the thing that I
no,
was
I'm
doing
just saying, how do you apologise to dead people?
You have just apologised, because actually the British monarchy, the Queen failed as a monarch, actually. Queen Elizabeth II failed as a monarch. They stopped short of ever apologising. King Charles needs to apologise. You get to reparations, yes, and you're saying, oh, well, we can't do reparations because that's too big a deal. But you haven't even said sorry.
Sorry be enough? If sorry seems to be the hardest word. Reparations, Bushra, good idea, bad idea.
I just think it's pointless. How are you going to hold people that have passed away, that are dead in their graves, accountable for stuff that was done centuries ago?
Because, Bushra,
you cannot do that
now.
But those families are not being affected by those historical conflicts. They're not, Narendra.
Who said colonisation isn't a problem now? Who said colonisation isn't around now? Brexit was all about imperialism and nationalism. Who said
no?
Hang on a minute,
Narendra. I want you on here because I want to have a good conversation with you once, and I don't want tweets from the GB News audience going, "I can't watch her screaming and shouting."
I want you
to express your point, to do it in the best possible way, and I got to just—it might be advice, and I may be being patronising, judging people.
I get judged.
Everyone gets judged. It's
right.
But let's make an objective point.
OK.
Really calmly, just tell us what the problem is here.
Colonization.
Why reparations are needed.
I'm not saying reparations are needed, but some kind of apology, acknowledgement, studied in our classrooms. We cannot look at colonisation with rose-tinted glasses because people died. Millions of people died. The wealth of this country was built on the backs of the oppression of black and brown people. And you can't say centuries ago, 1919 was the Amritsar Massacre. Thousands of people were killed. You can't bury these things.
Was the Qatar World Cup built on the backs of the slaves in Qatar?
I don't live in Qatar. I'm a British citizen, so that's of no concern to me.
OK, so you only care about...
I'm a British citizen.
Right, Bushra, last word before we go to debate. We'll be back to carry this on, guys, by the way. Bushra.
Honestly, Narendra, I'm going to put it out to you. You know, this isn't new. Being Great Britain and talking about colonisation, this is something that happened during war across the globe. It happened with Arabs.
It happened with
Indians.
The point
is, those are bounties of war. This is how empires were built. It was done with millions of people. But what we have to look at now is there are communities and families generations later that are in much better situations, especially in Great Britain.
Windrush.
We have everything at our hands here.
Windrush.
Okay, guys, okay. We are going to be back. And what we're going to do when we get back, actually, because, yes, we can talk about the past. That's fine. But when we get back, I want to talk about the future. And I'm going to have, I want both Narinder and Bushra to tell us what they think the solution to this very, very divisive identity politics world that we're living in now that is ripping society apart. Back in three. Welcome back, white colonisers. Now, you've been getting in touch to offer what you have to say, which is essentially why we're here anyway, to talk for you and with you. Anne says, Lawrence, you're absolutely right. The racism industry is totally out of control and it's making everyday life impossible. I really think it is. I think we're reaching this point where everything is about skin colour. Nothing is about the quality of what's going on inside someone. And it's just going to get worse and worse. I really agree with you. David said, Mr. Ben Habib was absolutely on the ball with his comments on immigration. We all know what's happening, but only GB News tells it straight. Keep it coming. Exactly why this channel, this great channel, exists. You will never hear anything like this anywhere else on British media, for better or for worse. But you can go and watch the BBC. Dave says, you're not alone. Our culture is being replaced and it's happening faster every year. Fully support you on this. Thank you. George, great monologues, dropping unwelcome truth bombs. Thanks, mate. On to the future. I'm going to go to you, Narinder, first. So what I was picking up from what you were saying was you feel that Britain hasn't sort of dealt with this. And even an apology would be enough, rather than, you know, reparations or anything like this. But you want a fully committed, emotional...
Yes. Yeah. That's exactly it. Okay. And honestly, this denial and this, oh, no, we didn't, and stop talking about it, silence our voices. You know, the younger generation... This matters to them. You know, I don't want the monarchy to go away, but the monarchy will be done. If the younger generation, recent YouGov polls, yes, they're not interested. And they're toppling down statues because it matters to them. We are a progressive, multicultural society. It matters to the younger generation. Now, if it matters to the younger generation, let's deal with it. As adults, like you just said, let's deal with it. Let's be adults about this and say, actually... What did we do in our colonisation, in our empire? Did we do wrong? Did we do right? I mean, you know, there's two okay, can exist. Both can exist.
I get what you're saying. I suppose the response to that...
And the kahuna does need to go back.
Well, OK.
It does.
OK, OK. That's okay. Your view. We all know what your view is.
Yeah.
The response to that might be every single society on Earth and every single culture on Earth has abused, destroyed, raped and pillaged its way through the world.
Not as much as Britain. We were the biggest empire in the world.
Okay.
Weren't we?
That's a subjective take on it. We may have been the biggest empire in the world, but we also bought the English language and equality and law. We bought some great things as well. Anyway, before we go back to that one, okay. Bushra, moving forward. What's the future? What's the Britain you want your family to grow up in and for the next generation of those that come after us?
OK, truth be told, we need to just figure out a way of how all of our cultures can come together in harmony, peacefully. And I know it seems like a long shot, but that's what needs to happen. And we're kind of veering towards that now. From where we were years ago, we are in a much better place. About the youngsters, and you know, I just want to make this point. It's not that they don't care about the royal family, because they do. Youngsters are very different today. They're actually just impartial. They're just not bothered about
stuff.
Seeing
the results.
That's obviously a different poll. However, youngsters just do... They just get on with what they're doing. Right now, you know, they're doing lots of hustles. They're online. They're just inventing new things. They're like, you know, they find things entertaining. Things about the royal family, bringing the youngsters into it, actually just... doesn't make any sense. Kids are kids.
That's incredibly naive.
I work on this channel, right? And I had to go in last week and do a thing on the monarchy. I've not made it that unobvious that I find Prince Charles a bit problematic.
Oh, you do?
Generally.
Why do you?
For many reasons, but okay. It's not about that. King Charles, sorry. But I was phoned up by the guys and said, remember, it's a coronation. It's a good time. Get focused, make it... And I was like, well, I don't feel like that. And they said, yeah, but it's not about you. So is there an idea to go... The vast majority of this country are either calling out for unity or division. So where would you draw a line of going, OK, if you just acknowledge that you did this wrong, will that be enough for all of the community?
It's a really good question. I don't know. I think for me an apology is enough, because King Charles... I actually think King Charles... has been left with a massive problem by Queen Elizabeth, because she failed as a monarch. He's been left with all these problems. And actually, I think King Charles does want to do something. He's actually approved of research going into slavery and the slavery links of the monarchy. I think if they acknowledge that, I think that's a help
direction. It's quite a lot to say, though. I don't want to interrupt you because I'm breaking my own rules. It's quite a lot to say to a woman who spent 70 years of her life going to public...
Failed as a monarch.
And you live in a country where you're absolutely all right to do that. If you went back to...
India, you would be able to say that.
If you went back to India and went, Narendra Modi is a failed loser, would you sleep safely at night? Tell me.
Possibly I wouldn't be sleeping safe at night.
Can I posit that that's one amazing thing about this country?
No, because I get death threats because of when I said about the St. George's flag. I get death threats.
Darling, so actually I'm join not... the internet
I know,
club,
I know, yes. I agree. It's a good point.
It's like, all I'm saying is I'm getting sparks from both of you. Not those sorts of sparks.
Oh, yeah, you are.
I'm getting sparks of going, that something's got to change.
Yeah, it has
something
to.
In this narrative has got to change. And I want us, before the end of this discussion, I want us to find what one thing that we can all agree on.
Mm, OK.
All right? What is it? So you want more accountability. You want
education. Education. People are ignorant to actually the truths. The truths.
OK.
What do I want? It's not even about what I want,
what do we need?
Lawrence. I think what we need to do is we need to leave the historical baggage behind. We need to leave that behind. It is no good for us as a community cohesively to move forward if we keep dragging the past continuously. And we've got to get over it. Because, and I'm sorry, as harsh as that may sound to people, it is the truth.
Hang on.
No, it's not. And this isn't about feelings. This is about logic, practicality, and what the country looks like. So we need to leave our feelings and emotions at the table. People are buried. Historical events are dead and buried. Let's build a better future.
You sound ignorant, Bushra. You sound so ignorant.
What did we agree at the beginning of this conversation?
I can't believe I'm ignorant.
We agreed at the beginning of the conversation,
saying,
we weren't going
to
go personal.
We need
personal.
To leave it.
What do you know about her?
But she's saying leave it, and how can you leave something that's not acknowledged?
You've got a big mouth and a big opinion. She's got an opinion. She's entitled to express it on the TV.
And she can.
Her position is... I'm moderating this. Her position is we leave the past in the past, because let's face it, none of us need to be Einstein to work out theory.
Then why
theory
are the problems
relativity.
Happening
we
now?
We cannot change it.
But why are voices becoming louder then?
Sorry, I'm so bad at moderating.
You are good at it.
Go calm laws. Bushra says we need to put grievance culture and identity politics to bed. Can you tell me in a calm and reasonable way why that's a bad idea?
It's a really good idea if it was acknowledged in the first place. And if acknowledgement and apology is done, and you return stolen artefacts, we can then leave it. We can draw a line under it all, and
why do you get to deal? I don't.
So either of us do. Some of us have to. Then we've got to come to some compromise, Lawrence.
Narendra, half of these artefacts that you keep bringing up continuously, right? They're probably not even safe in the governments that currently exist. Number one, if the Kohinoor was to return to India, that Kohinoor is also claimed by Afghanistan, Iran, Pakistan, and India. It would cause its own problem. So we need to get over those conversations.
Sounds ridiculous. That sounds
to
ridiculous.
You, to you, it might that, do,
actually,
but it's still a suggestion.
I'll steal your phone. It's safer in my pocket. Because it's not safe in your house because your kids might steal it. It sounds ridiculous.
Narendra, it changed so many hands. It changed so many hands.
It's founded in India.
Right. All right. I'm sorry. I'm scores on the doors here, guys. Narendra.
Yes.
I completely understand that you feel that wrongs have been done and that they haven't been acknowledged.
Yeah, I feel upset. I feel like crying.
That's okay. I think people would have some support there.
Yeah,
even
absolutely.
Though Bushra is sort of a little bit more objective about it, and she's saying, look, this diamond is claimed by everybody. And maybe you pose it. Regardless, Bushra, I feel, scores on the doors for me is that Bushra has said, I think we need to start ushering in the end of identity politics.
Yeah.
You know, but Bushra is a Muslim as far as...
I am, yeah, Muslim.
And I'm a Christian, right? We're different religions. I mean...
Yeah, I'm Indian.
Yeah, that's fine. But I'm just saying, sometimes those things about looking at things in a different way, which is you can't dig up the past all the time because, you know, you can't
never
then
been
live.
Dug up. It's
but,
never been
But if
dug
we
up.
Agree that we want to yes. dig it up, Indian History Month, would that help?
A month? No, no, we need to really acknowledge the past and then we can move. I want to move forward. I live in this country. It doesn't.
If I was your therapist, I would say you don't want to move forward.
Oh, I'm desperate to move forward. I live in this country. I'm a proud British citizen.
I know you are.
I'm proud. You know I am. You
know
me.
I do. And I'm just saying, right. if I was your therapist, I'd say, do you really want to move forward or do you want to stay where you are?
But, Lawrence, do you think society as we are now, the youth of today, do you not want us to be united? Do you not think the youth deserve some... They don't want this,
I think they deserve a future devoid of our past. That's what I feel. Right, we yes. have only a very short amount of time. Now, listen, I know that some of you guys were like, oh, I don't want to have this conversation, but we are entering this place as a country where we're going to have this conversation, and it's going to have to be really serious, because the more we try and divide people down ridiculous things like skin colour lines, we've got to come together for a solution. Thank you, both of my panellists,
well
for giving
done.
Me your thing.